because we are kings and our words matter. Why were they like that? They were Abraham's children, entitled to every blessing of Abraham, but yet did not enjoy the blessings of Abraham. Why? God says, don't ask me what's wrong with me. Nothing is wrong with me. Consider your ways.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy
Sam Chelladurai speaks at the Believers Conference in Colombo on 5th March 2015 from 9 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. The venue is Havelock City Clubhouse, 324 Havelock Road, Colombo 5. Prior registration is required. To register, please contact the numbers on the screen.
Paul's Epistle to Galatians, chapter 3. Verses 13 and 14. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Why did God bless Abraham materially? Why material blessing seemed to be important for God to bless Abraham with? Abraham never asked for material blessings. He didn't know anything about it. But God nevertheless blessed him beyond measure. Why? The reason is God said when he first met him and called him, he said, in you shall all the nation be blessed. All the nations or all the families of the earth, one translation says, be blessed. Every family will be blessed through Abraham. How? Only one way. That is Jesus Christ, the Savior, will be born through Abraham and he will provide salvation for everyone. Now, because this was the agenda, this was God's program, God was going to bring Jesus through Abraham. God took special care of Abraham because he cannot perish in the flood, in the famine, in the hands of the enemy, because Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, is to be born through him. So he was a specially protected, specially blessed man because he was going to bring forth Jesus, and Jesus will bring salvation for everyone. Now people say, well, already salvation has come. Jesus has come. He died on the cross. Salvation has come. Then why does the Bible say, why does Paul say that Jesus died on the cross so that the blessing of Abraham, the very same blessings that Abraham had, might come upon all of us? Why the same blessings on us? Since the program is over now, Jesus has come. Why bless us with the same blessings? Well, he blesses us with the same blessings for this reason, that even though the Savior has come and salvation has been provided, now the salvation has to be proclaimed to every creature. And that is where we come in. That is why we become so important in the plan and purpose of God. We are so important, just as important as Abraham for God, because without us, the gospel cannot be proclaimed to the whole world. That is why we will be specially protected and we will be specially cared for and we will be specially provided for. That is what the Bible teaches. This is what I'm trying to emphasize. That you and I are in the plan and purpose of God. And when we understand it, we will walk in prosperity. We will walk in the blessings of God, in the very blessings of Abraham. It's so important for us to realize that. You know, it is so important to realize why God gives us material blessings. When I came into ministry, I first of all found out one thing, one great truth. When I entered upon ministry, when I went to study, the one thing that was very distinctly different was that as soon as I went to study, I was left without money. No money. So the first lesson in life I had to learn was how to get the money. Now that's what scared me about ministry in the first place. I didn't want to get into the ministry because all the ministers that I saw were suffering for lack of money. So I said, God, please call me to do anything, but don't call me to preach. My favorite verse was James chapter 3 verse 1. Do not let many of you be teachers because you'll receive greater condemnation, it says. So I used to tell my father all the time, look at this verse. Don't tell me to be a preacher, you know, because I saw that preachers were suffering, you know, the suffering kind. So when you give yourself to be a preacher, you're giving up, giving yourself for suffering. That's what I thought. So one of the greatest things that I decided to learn was I decided if I'm going to carry out the mandate of Jesus Christ and preach the gospel to the whole world, then I got to know how these riches and wealth works. I got to find out how to bring in enough money to do the work that God wants me to do. I can't be poor and do all the work that Jesus wants me to do. So I had to spend some time. I really got into that. You can tell I got into that. I can preach on this forever. I got into that and I began to look into the Bible to see what riches and wealth are for. Why God gives wealth to men. Because the Bible says, the blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich. The Bible says, remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the power to get wealth. Why wealth? Why did God call Abraham, a guy that was living in darkness, didn't even know God, and tell him, I'll bless you? Why? He didn't ask for no blessing. God says, I'll bless you. Why does he want to bless him? Why did he make him a man with gold and silver, cattle, and male and female servant? He was a very rich man, the Bible says. Why was it important for God to take a man from ordinary background and make him something extraordinary in terms of material wealth also? Why did he give him that? Why? Why is there wealth in this world? Why did God put wealth in this world? Why God gives it to men? I had to look into it, and that's the revelation I'm preaching. I have found the answer, and the answer is this, that wealth is there in this world, and wealth is given by God to men and women, especially the saints of God. He even takes the wealth of the wicked and gives it to the saints, the Bible says. The reason is this, because he wants his gospel to go to the ends of this world so that every creature will know who Jesus Christ is and come to salvation. I have discovered that ever since I discovered, I have no shame about preaching this. Let people think whatever they want to think. I'm going to preach this because I know why wealth is there. The ones that don't believe it, the ones that have not discovered it, the ones that don't preach it, they are to be ashamed of that. I am not ashamed. I am not ashamed because I know why God gives wealth today. The purpose of wealth is understood. And that's the revelation I'm preaching to you today. Turn with me to Haggai. Haggai chapter 1, verse 6. You have sown much and bring in little. You eat but do not have enough. You drink but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves but no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put into a bag with holes. How do you like that? Amazing. God says, hey, you got a problem. These are Abraham's children. Now they are suffering. In what way are they suffering? They are suffering financially, materially they are suffering. Now material suffering is one thing that Abraham's children shouldn't have. Because Abraham was a mighty, mighty rich guy. He would have been ashamed of the way these people lived. He never knew anything like this. Abraham was a man who reaped where he never sowed. He prospered in the midst of famine. He was a different kind of man. He was a blessed man. And his grandchildren are now in trouble. In what way are they in trouble? They have sown much but reap little. In modern ways, in modern terms, let me say it like this. You work so hard but earn very little. Hello? A lot of people work so hard in this world today and come up with very little to show in their hands. What's the problem? The answer is what we're going to find out. God promised riches to Abraham. God promised wealth to Abraham. One of the blessings of Abraham is wealth and riches, but these people don't seem to have it. Even though the word of God is there, even though the promises of God is given to them, these people don't seem to walk in it. They sow much and reap little. Work so hard, but come up with very little. Why? What is the problem? Why are they not earning enough? Why are they not prospering? Has God forgotten them? Are the promises of God not true? Don't God come true with his promises? Is God a liar? Can we believe the Bible? Does the God of Abraham fulfill his promises to his children? Has God left them, forgotten them, abandoned them? I tell you, my friend, a lot of people, even some sitting here may be thinking, well, brother, God has abandoned me. God doesn't care for me. Oh, I've tried so hard. I've worked so hard, but still I've not seen prosperity. I've struggled and struggled and struggled years together. I've only struggled and I've never gotten ahead. I go one step ahead and come two steps backward. I don't know what's wrong. I don't know why this is happening to me. I don't know why God doesn't show me any mercy. I don't know why God doesn't give me grace to get ahead in life and have enough and much more than enough like many other people have. You may be wondering that. I'll tell you, my friend, that's what this is all about. He says, you sow much, but you reap very little. Why? He says, you eat, but you do not have enough. Isn't that something? You eat, but not enough. Never there is a satisfaction, the Tamil Bible says. You eat, but you're not eaten till you're satisfied. You're always eating half stomach full. You drink, but you're not filled with drink. Problem. There also, shortages there also. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. You clothe yourself, but the clothing that you wear is not enough to keep you warm. There's scanty little clothing. There's not much. You can't purchase more. You can't have the kind of clothing that you need to clothe yourself properly. You're not warm. In those days, you know, to keep warm, you needed warm clothing. And these people, they clothed, but it was never enough. They were living on a shortage basis. That's what is happening to them. And he who earns wages, listen to this, earns wages to put into a bag with holes. Now, what's the use of earning if you're going to put into a bag with holes? To put it in a pocket with holes. Now, let me say it in modern language. A lot of people say, I've earned so much, brother, but I don't know where it went. So much money came into my hands, but I don't know where. Nothing to show today. I have nothing left. So much money brought in, But everything seems to go into some pocket with holes. Have you ever felt like that? There's a pocket with holes. What is the reason for such an existence? Why do people live like that? Why are they like that? Now, sometimes people are looking to God and saying, God, what's wrong with you? As if God's got something wrong. Because they are in problem. They're saying, God, what's wrong? You don't hear my prayers? You don't do what you said? You know, Pastor Sam preaches saying that you meet all my needs, but there's nothing coming through. Where are you? God, I'm crying out. Where are you? As if something is wrong with God. People are ready to believe something may be wrong with God, but they're not ready to believe that something may be wrong with them. Listen to this. Next verse. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. God says, you got a problem? You work so much and earn very little? You eat and are not satisfied? You drink and you're never full? And you clothe and you're never warm? You earn money only to put it in a pocket with holes? Consider your ways. God's saying, don't ask me where I am. Don't be telling me, oh God, what happened? I fasted and prayed for 3 days, no answer. Don't check me out, God says. Check yourself out. Consider your ways. Check yourself out. See what's wrong with you, my friend. What has gone wrong? Why are you like that? Because the promises of God are there. God is good. God never fails. God never lies. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but his word shall not pass away. In light of that, then why are people like this? I'm talking about Christian people, God's people, just like the people of Israel at that time were a covenant people, God's people. Why were they like that? They were Abraham's children, entitled to every blessing of Abraham, but yet did not enjoy the blessings of Abraham. Why? God says, don't ask me what's wrong with me. Nothing is wrong with me. Consider your ways. Oh, there is an awful silence here. Consider your ways. Many years ago, I began to consider my ways. And I came to the conclusion that if I will have lack and want, it's not because God has forgotten me. It is not because God abandons me. It is not God doesn't think about me or God doesn't keep his promises. I found out that God is always good, is always true. He never lies and his promises always come through. But when there's something wrong, when I am not satisfied, when I am not filled with good things, when my needs are not met, then I must consider my ways. What is wrong with me? I must consider my ways. What is wrong with these people? Go back to verse 2. Thus speaks the Lord of hosts, saying, this people says, the time has not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. Now let me give you the background. These people just returned from the captivity of Babylon. It's been a few years since they returned from the captivity of Babylon. You know about the captivity of Babylon. They were all taken captive. Not because God forgot them once again. These bad things never happened in their life because God is no good and God didn't keep them, protect them and all that. God especially protected them. But every time they rebelled against God, disbelieved God, acted against God, went after all kinds of things. So God, you know, every time God has been faithful, but these people have never been faithful. They landed themselves in the captivity. They brought heaps of trouble upon themselves. They ended up in captivity under the Babylonians. The Babylonians came and took them lock, stock and barrel back to Babylon. Drove them like herding animals, you know. Just took them back to Babylon and made them workers there. Came under slavery again, under Babylon. And when they did that, they destroyed their city of Jerusalem and the temple, everything was destroyed and it was all in shambles. Many years they spent there in Babylon. And then once again, God, you know, brought them out. Every time God is bringing them out. God is not the one that landed them there. God is helping them. Whenever they turn to God and repent, God says, all right, I'll take you out now. So God brought them out. When he brought them out, look, consider the wonderful grace of God. When God brought them out, the king of the country which took them into captivity, he, now this was a different man. He was a He said, I'll give you the money to go back and repair your walls, build the walls of Jerusalem. I'll give you money to go back and build your temples. I will finance it. Now, I'm not surprised by it at all. God is the best financier in the whole world that I have ever seen. God has ways of financing. Now, all those that are in financing, let me introduce a new concept. God is a wonderful financier. How did he finance the tabernacle? The first time when they were brought out of the bondage of Egypt, the slavery of Egypt. You remember? They came into the wilderness. God said, build for me a tabernacle according to this specification, God told Moses. And gave him the exact specification that required gold and silver and all kinds of precious things. So God said, build this tabernacle. How would they build that tabernacle? They needed a lot of gold and silver, and these were slaves. They spent many, many years in slavery, had nothing. Poor, half stomach full, you know, just like it is described here, they didn't have enough. They were living, even though they're blessed people, they didn't walk in the blessings. They had lack and want in their lives. For so many years, they've not seen the light of day, and they've not seen prosperity. And he tells them, build it with gold and silver. How would they build it? You see, God is a very smart God. Before he told them do it, he gave them what is needed to do it. How did he give it to them? Turn with me to Exodus chapter 11, verse 2 and 3. Speak now in the hearing of the people, and let every man ask from his neighbor and every woman from her neighbor articles of silver and articles of gold. How do you like that? God says, go to your neighbor and ask for articles of silver and articles of gold. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. Moreover, the man Moses was very great in the land of Egypt, in the sight of Pharaoh's servants, and in the sight of the people. Now, God not only told them, go and ask. He also went to the people who they're going to ask and gave them favor in their sight and made Moses great in their eyes. He worked on the other side also. So that when they went and asked, they gave. Now you try go and you don't try to go and ask your neighbor for gold and silver, because they'll report you to the police. You know, if they're kind enough. Otherwise, a normal man will beat you up if you go and ask for gold and silver, you know. That's what you'll get. This is a very unusual thing. You don't do such things like that. But when God says it, God not only speaks to you, but God goes to the other side and makes sure that guy is set right. He tells him, you better give it. Otherwise, you're finished, you know. When he comes and asks for gold and silver, you better give it. And makes Moses big and great and mighty in the eyes of the people and in the eyes of Pharaoh, so that everyone is afraid. They just take off everything and give it to them. How do you like that? So God works on both sides. I remember one fellow came, walked into my office one day and said, the Lord told me, brother, that next Sunday that I must preach in your church. I said, praise the Lord, brother. I said, praise the Lord. But you have to wait, because he must tell me also. He said, you don't believe me? I said, no, I believe you absolutely. But I believe him more absolutely. I believe him more. Besides that, he's already in me. He knows my address. He knows how to talk to me. And I'm hearing what he's saying to me. If he says that you must preach, then I'm ready. You preach. He said, oh, but you must believe me. God has told me. I said, no. God will tell me also. I heard about one guy that went to a woman, you know, because a woman came to me many years ago with her father in big, great distress, you know. Husband was working in some Gulf country, and she was putting away some money, you know, in the bank now and then, saving up for building a house. They've got a land and wanted to build a house. Somewhere, and she was making fixed deposits of 15,000 rupees at a time. So this guy, I don't know who this guy, some kind of a guy, he found out that this lady's got some money, and he came and said, lady, you got that 15,000 in the bank? God told me to give it to me. Told me that you should give it to me for the work of the Lord. So that lady, you know, didn't know all this teaching about how the Lord says and speaks and all that. She said, if the Lord has told you, brother, then I'll go and withdraw it. But I got to ask my husband. He said, no, the Lord told me that you don't have to ask husband. How do you like that guy? The Lord told me you don't have to ask your husband. I don't believe in stuff like that, you know. Husband and wives are partners. You don't do without telling each other what you're doing, you know. And a guy who tells you do it without telling your husband is totally wrong, no matter what he says. Is totally there. Right then and there, you should know that he's wrong. He said, don't tell your husband, because God told me not to tell your husband that he is a heathen. He won't understand. He's an ungodly person. He won't understand. So without telling your husband, you give it and I will give it back to you later. So she gave the 15,000 and the guy just went, skipped the town and left with the money. And now the husband is coming back home from the Gulf. And the father came to me and he cried. He was about to catch a hold of my feet. He said, brother, you got to help me, because this husband of hers is not an ordinary guy. He will take a big knife and cut her head off. I said, you know very much. You got a good revelation about that, brother, that he'll take a big knife and cut her head off. Then why did you give the money? You got to be much more careful. Why did he give the money? He said, because he said the Lord said, brother. Why didn't you ask him first? He said, because the Lord said. I said, doesn't the Lord say anything to you? You're a Christian, you're a believer. Doesn't the Lord say anything to you? Why do you do this? Doesn't the Lord speak to you? Does the Lord speak only to those people and he never speaks to you? You see, God is always a person who makes things right. When God does things, he does things properly.
Sam Chelladure speaks at the Believers Conference in Colombo on 5th March 2015 from 9 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. The venue is Havelock City Clubhouse, 324 Havelock Road, Colombo 5. Prior registration is required. To register, please contact the numbers on the screen.
This is the season of Jubilee.
This is the season of Jubilee.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Put your hands together. Everybody praise the Lord. Put your hands together. Sing, shout, and praise the Lord. This is the season of Jubilee.
This is the season of Jubilee.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Put your hands together. Everybody praise the Lord. Put your hands together. Sing and shout and praise the Lord.